So we are going to study locking protocols, and the first locking protocol that we will study is called the two-phase locking protocol or the 2PL. The 2PL is a more common term probably, and this is the two-phase locking protocol. So there is, why is it called two-phase? We will see. There are essentially two phase. In the phase one, the phase one is also called the growing phase, growing or the locking phase. In this growing phase or phase one, a transaction may only obtain locks. It may not release. It may not release locks. So it can only get locks. It cannot release locks. So that's the growing phase. And the complementary is the phase two, which is the shrinking phase or the unlocking phase, where, as probably you can already guess what is going to happen here, is that a transaction may only release locks. It may not obtain locks. So these are the important things. So what is essentially happening is that there are two distinct phases. In the first phase, all the transactions can simply request for locks. It can only request and it cannot release any of the locks. In the second phase, the transactions can only release the locks, but it cannot get any more locks. So very simply, the way to think of it, this is that in the first phase, all the transactions just request for all the locks without releasing any one of them. Because once it starts releasing, that's second phase, it cannot obtain anything. So essentially all the transactions first request for all the locks that it will need to complete the transaction. So the locks on all the items that it will need, that's the growing phase or the locking phase. And in the second phase, the unlocking phase, it will just keep on releasing these things. It will not ask for any more locks. So these are the two phase locking protocol. Now it can be shown, couple of things can be done, is that this two phase locking protocol, 2PL, can be shown to be conflict serializable. This is very, very interesting. So the two phase locking protocol is conflict serializable. Now there can be proof of it, but intuitively it can be said that the two phase locking protocol, the schedules, this is serialized. So this can be serialized, this is equivalent to a serial schedule where the order of the transaction in the serial thing is serialized in the order of something called a lock points. So what is the lock point? In the order of lock points, all right. So a lock point is the time when a transaction gets all the locks. So that is the thing. So that this is called the lock point of a transaction. So what I am trying to say is the lock point is the following. Is that suppose transaction one wants a lock on item A and item B. So once it gets item A, it still not got hold of the lock point. Once it gets also the lock for item B, it will then attain what is called the lock point. Now do note that in the two phase locking protocol, transaction one, after it has got the lock of A, it will not release A. It will first try to get all the locks, which means it will get the lock of B before it will start releasing all the points. And after it has got the locks of all the items that it wants, that is when it's got the lock point. That means the transaction then holds the locks for everything that it needs. So that's the lock point of a transaction. So it is scheduled, then it can be serialized in the order of the lock point. So whichever transaction gets into the lock point first is the first transaction in the equivalent serial schedule of a two-phase schedule. So and two-phase schedule is conflict serializable, that can be proved, okay. So this is the important part. However, conflict serializable protocols may still suffer from the problem of deadlock, because a transaction one wants the locks, and as we saw the example, actually that is actually in a two-phase locking protocol, because none of the transactions has released any locks, it was just trying to get it, and it can of course enter into a deadlock, because transaction one gets the lock of A and it wants B, while transaction two has got the lock of B and it wants A. So this is the basic two-phase locking protocol. And it may simply suffer from the problem of deadlock. So here is probably an example too, just to highlight the point. Deadlock. So and the schedule that exemplifies that it may suffer from the deadlock. So this is a very simple example of how it can deadlock. So at this point, the system is deadlocked. The two-phase locking protocol can also suffer from the problem of cascading rollbacks. If you remember, the cascading rollbacks is that when one transaction aborts, other transaction has to abort as a result of that, and then some other transactions may have to abort and so on and so forth. So that may also happen. And here is an example for this. So let me first put on the example. And at this point, what happens is that transaction 1 aborts. So if transaction 1 aborts, so everything has been going on fine, now transaction 1 has aborted, right? So that means this is all, this write operation is essentially invalidated. So this should not go through. That means this read is invalidated. That means this write is also invalidated. That means this read is also invalidated. So essentially, if A1 happens, then transaction 2 must abort and transaction 3 must abort. So this is a cascading rollback. But note that this is in the two-phase protocol, because for every transaction, it gets the locks and then it releases it. It gets the locks and then it releases it. It gets the lock and then it releases it. It's getting all the locks that it wants. So it's a simple way to see that this is still in two-phase locking protocol, but it can suffer from this problem of cascading rollbacks. Okay, so it can suffer from both the, so the basic two-phase protocol, this is the basic two-phase protocol that we have been studying, it can suffer from the problems of both deadlock and cascading rollbacks. Fine. So there are some variants of the two-phase locking protocol. So the first thing, of course, we studied is the basic one. So this is the basic, this is called the basic two-phase locking protocol. This is the basic protocol that we have just studied. Then there is something called a strict two-phase locking protocol. So a strict two-phase locking protocol, the following thing happens is the transaction must hold all its exclusive locks till it commits. So it holds X locks till it commits. So a transaction must hold its X locks till it commits or abort. Okay, so let us see what this happens is that, so transaction holds the exclusive. So what it means is that once it has got an exclusive lock for writing, essentially exclusive lock is used for writing, it will hold on to it unless it commits or aborts. So what is the effect? That means that suppose the transaction commits and then it releases this lock. That means that the lock that it has got did its job correctly, of course, and the write operation is also successful. So anything that reads after this will be correct. The point is, since it holds the lock, no other transaction can start reading that particular data item unless it releases the locks, and it has released the lock only after it has committed. That means only after it has made sure that the write that it has done is correct. Otherwise, of course, it just aborts and then releases it, but then no other transaction will have any effect on this because it cannot read. So there is in no way any other transaction can read that particular data item before it commits or before it releases the locks, and by that time the transaction is either committed or aborted, so it has essentially taken the decision. So this means that there is no cascading rollback in this. So there is no cascading rollback in this strict two-phase locking protocol because it cannot, so the cascading rollback happens because another transaction reads a particular data item that has been written but not committed or aborted, and that cannot happen because it holds all the exclusive locks. And it produces strict schedules because nobody can even write to that other data item because it still holds the X locks before it commits or aborts. So this is called, it produces strict schedules, and that is why you can see that why it is called a strict two-phase locking protocol, because it produces the strict schedules. However, it may still deadlock. So the problem of deadlock still remains. And again, it is easy to prove that it may deadlock. And I invite you to think of an example to show that in a strict two-phase locking protocol, it may still deadlock. Okay, fine. So that is the strict two-phase locking protocol. Then there is something called a rigorous two-phase locking protocol. So here what happens is a transaction holds all locks till it commits. So it holds S, X both locks till it commits or aborts. So a rigorous two-phase locking protocol is of course strict because it holds on to its locks, and it is it also holds on to the shared lock. It doesn't even release a shared lock till it aborts or commits. So this is again of course can be serialized in the order of the, so this can be serialized simply in the order of their commits, but this is the same properties. It holds on to this no cascading roll song and all of these things. So no cascading rollback and strict schedules it may do, and it deadlocks also. So the fourth one in this is called the conservative or sometimes called the static two-phase locking protocol. So this is an important thing. Transaction gets, so by the way, rigorous two-phase locking protocol can also deadlock because the simply because one transaction wants another lock, the transaction one wants a lock on B while transaction two wants a lock on A, and transaction one holds the lock on A and transaction 2 holds the locks on B. So nothing. So it only says that it cannot, it does not release till it commits or abort, but doesn't say how to get it. So the deadlock may also happen. In a conservative two-phase protocol, transaction gets all the locks in an atomic manner. And now this requires a little bit more thought of what is this happening. So what does an atomic manner mean? So a transaction essentially at the beginning of it, it declares the intent of getting all the locks. So it will say, okay, I want an exclusive lock on A and a shared lock on B and an exclusive lock on C and etc. And it requests all of those locks together. So both transaction 1 does it and transaction 2 does it. And what the concurrency control protocol manager will do is that it either honors all the lock requests together or it doesn't honor anything. So what I am trying to say is that if a transaction 1 wants the locks on A, B and C, either it will get all the locks on A, B and C or it will get none of the locks. So it's atomic, that's why it's called all the locks in an atomic manner. So it cannot happen that it will get the lock on A but not on B and C, and it will get a lock on A and B but not on C, so on and so forth. So very simply you can see that if this happens, then this cannot deadlock, right? What is the deadlock situation? The deadlock situation is that there are two transactions holding locks that the other one wants. Now this cannot happen because if transaction 1 wants a lock on B and holds on A, it cannot happen. It cannot want a lock on B while holding A because either it has got both A and B or it has got none of them. And the same thing for transaction 2. So there is no deadlock. So this is deadlock free. And as an implementation detail or as a more detail of these things, each transaction declares what it's called its read set and write set, and it gets the shared locks. If it wants, it can get the shared locks on read set and the exclusive locks on write set. But essential idea is that it either gets all the locks or it gets none of the locks. So that is why it cannot deadlock. So that is the whole point of this conservative or static two-phase locking protocol. So these are the four variants of the two-phase locking protocol. Essentially, just to summarize, the two-phase locking protocol, every transaction must first get all the locks and then only it can start releasing the locks.